Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Yes, I'm very happy to be here. I'm also happy to be here virtually. I would have, of course, loved to be there in person in Istanbul, but we have to make the best out of the situation. And today I will present to you about the topic of blockchain, and I will give you mostly an overview about the concepts that you can maybe translate to many application domains from there. But I will also show some code and real examples to make things more concrete, because I don't like these blockchain talks that keep everything super abstract and fluffy. So we will see some nice computer science stuff and also some code topics. A little bit about my person. My name is Kevin Wittek. I'm a doctoral researcher at the Institute for Internet Security in Germany, where I'm leading the blockchain research lab. So I'm very deep in the topic of blockchain nowadays, although my background is a classical software engineering background. So I just came into this topic for my PhD and for going back to academia. So I'm like 1 year now in blockchain. So I'm a little bit fresh still in the field, and I have the understanding of the normal software engineering part of things. And besides of working as a researcher, I'm also an kind of a freelancer doing consulting or coaching workshops and so on, mostly on the topic of test containers. So I'm one of the test containers maintainer. And on Saturday, you can join my test containers workshop, which has nothing to do with blockchain, but with test containers. And yes, someone is correct. Like, the picture on the right is a photo from Istanbul. I don't know the name of the hill. It's this big hill kind of in the middle that overlooks everything. And that's me with my wife. And my wife is from Istanbul. And yes, I love the city very much. So I miss visiting it. But let's hope I can be back in the future and maybe for next Java Day Istanbul or for the Java group again. Yeah, and so I'm also Oracle Groundbreaker Ambassador, not too important, and now I'm involved in some of the blockchain-related activities. But yeah, you don't have to know them if you don't know about blockchain yet. So the question is about blockchain. Blockchain has been a big hype topic, and some people would say, okay, it's just a hype, it's bullshit, we don't need it. But some others say, okay, it might revolutionize IT, it might revolutionize the internet, it might even revolutionize society to a certain degree. And I like to start with a small story about Nasreddin Hoxha, and maybe you know about this story. So one day Nasreddin Hoxha walks over to a lake with a bucket in his hand, and he starts pouring spoonful of yogurt into the lake. And a villager sees Nasreddin Hoxha, and he's wondering, okay, why he's pouring yogurt into the lake? And then he asks, okay, what's up, Hoxha? What on earth are you doing there? Why do you pour yogurt into the lake? And then Nasreddin answers, I'm turning the lake into yogurt. And then the villager says, Hoxha, could a lake ever be fermented? Could it become a yogurt? And then Nasreddin says, you never know. Yatu Tarza. So, will blockchain revolutionize our lives? You never know. Yatu Tarza. So I hope this is a nice motivation to start this topic. And I really like to look back into the... What are you going to do with amount of yogurt? Yes. So yes, what are you going to do if everything became blockchain? Good question. So I like to think about the historic context of things. I'm not only a computer science nerd, I'm also kind of a history nerd, but especially the history of computer science. I love this. And if we look at blockchain and the history of blockchain, we can spin up a very nice history that starts with the early concepts for the time sharing systems and time sharing computers, and goes to the vision we have nowadays from what can a blockchain be. It's really the historic context that can start back in the 60s and the 70s, back when the whole concept of time sharing operating system started with the Unix guys you see here, Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie, working at Bell Labs and just about to invent Unix. So we can make a story that sounds like this. We can say, okay, this story and the history of computing is to a certain degree the history of utility computing. Utility computing meaning providing computing as a resource pool that is shared and that can be used demanding on your needs. And that is the original idea of the time sharing operation systems that were the foundation for Unix operating systems. So back then, the people at MIT, at Bell Labs that were working on those, on Multics, that is a precursor to Unix to a certain degree, were thinking about, okay, how can we model computing resources in such a way that they act similar to common pool resources, such as telephone networks or electric power grids. And that was the idea of the original multi-user operating systems. The idea was, okay, all those universities will have those computing hardware, we will connect them to networks, and people will be able to use these computing resources depending on their needs. Is really one of the starts of modern computing is this train of thought to utility computing. And then the very successful development from there, of course, was the ARPANET, which is the foundation for the internet, and later the World Wide Web as envisioned by Tim Berners-Lee. This came in the 60s. In the 89, we had Tim Berners-Lee inventing the World Wide Web at CERN. And at the same, or a bit earlier in the 70s, we had the project Xanadu and the DocuVerse, which was a more or less also a research project, and it was conceptually already a precursor for the context of hypertext in the, or hypermedia. So a networking of resources, of documents referencing each other. And it was in some ways a bit more visionary than the way the World Wide Web implemented hypermedia even. But it never became real, kind of. So they are still developing it, I think, in Japan, but there is no real implementation of Xanadu stuff, as far as I know. And of course, nowadays, we live in the era of cloud computing. And in a certain degree, cloud computing is also a utility computing, just the utilities are very centralized at the cloud providers. But the idea is you will just pay for the resources you need. And we had Amazon with EC2 2006, the first start of this contact. So, and now I say the idea of the Bitcoin network that started in 2009 is a new concept for utility computing, and it is a worldwide distributed decentralized state machine. In 2015, we had Ethereum network, which is another blockchain technology that expanded on this idea and not only gives us a decentralized state machine, it also adds a quasi Turing complete virtual machine to it with a programming language that makes it programmable. So we get a world computer kind of with a decentralized state. That's pretty cool in a network. And now what might be the next steps is a network of networks. That is what, where the blockchain community is moving towards too. One of the core ideas behind the blockchain stuff, also how we touch it nowadays, is the concept of adding a new form of trust. And the original paper that proposed Bitcoin from 2008, from the pseudonym Satoshi Nakamoto. So he published this paper, but no one actually knows who Satoshi is. And it was just published on a mailing list, a cryptographic mailing list for cryptographic topics. And it was coined Bitcoin, a peer-to-peer electronic cash system. And there it says, we have proposed a system for electronic transaction without relying on trust. And this is a core idea of all those blockchain network systems, that you are not relying on trust. At least that's what they say. I would challenge this assumption. So in reality, they still rely on trust, but they add a new concept of trust. It's called distributed trust. Classical trust models, we have something like peer-to-peer trust, you trust another person. We have something like Leviathan trust, you are trusting in the laws as defined by the government. And then we have one of the trust architectures that we see very often in IT systems, which is intermediary trust, that you're trusting a third party. So for example, when we do transactions, online transactions, monetary online transactions, we might trust PayPal. as an intermediary. Or I think PayPal is forbidden in Turkey. Or yeah, then Yapı Kredi or something. Yeah, you are trusting a bank. You very often have this. And this new concept of distributed trust, you don't have the central entity you trust anymore. You're trusting the network and the logic and the protocols as implemented in the network. But now they say, the Satoshi paper says you don't have to rely on trust. And this I challenge, because you still have this trust factor. And it just changes. You now trust technology. But what does trusting technology mean? And I love this paper from Ken Thompson, or it's from a speech. This paper is a speech he held when he got the Turing Award. And it's called Reflections on Trusting Trust. And he says, to what extent should one trust a statement that a program is free of Trojan horses? Perhaps it is more important to trust the people who wrote the software. And with all those blockchain topics, whenever people say like, oh, when you have blockchain, when you have smart contracts, you don't need to trust anymore the people, you can trust the systems. This doesn't make sense, because the people write the code that runs the blockchain. So the people write the code that encodes those rules. We still have to trust the people. We maybe have more transparency, because if it's open source, we can see the code. But still, this doesn't solve the trust problem from a human level. Just it shifts it. And it is a new form of trust, distributed trust. This is true. So blockchain. How is blockchain seen in the mind of the normal developer or at IT person, maybe? So mostly blockchain is connected to Bitcoin. Bitcoin made blockchain famous. And Bitcoin in the context of cryptocurrency. But we can also think about blockchain in other domains that are far from cryptocurrency. And we will look into this a little bit later, I hope. So here we see the historic development of the Bitcoin network. How the number of transactions we get mined per month. So it's actually like a business transaction, like sending money from A to B. And here we see the usage of the Bitcoin network. And it started in 2009 and is a logarithmic scale. So be aware of this. And we kind of are in a stable form. Like we have roughly 10 million transactions per month that get executed in Bitcoin. That sounds like a high amount, but compared to credit card transaction, it's tiny. So there are many, many, many more Visa transactions every month, credit card transactions. But still, it is a productive network that can be used for money-like transactions. And in this context, of course, it's important that many people associate blockchain with Bitcoin, which is a cryptocurrency. And there is this interesting thing about Bitcoin having a quite volatile value. So here we see the value development of Bitcoin as compared to the dollar since 2014, roughly. And we see like, oh, there were crazy spikes and it went down, then it goes up, then it stabilized a bit, but it's still very volatile. So it is not directly currently a good replacement to normal classic currencies. Although this depends actually on the country you are in. So there are countries in which the state currencies are sometimes even more volatile as Bitcoin. So it's a bit unfair to say, okay, we cannot use Bitcoin as a currency because it's so volatile, because for some countries, their currencies are also very volatile and they are also virtual to a certain degree. But basically we have this idea of Bitcoin and speculating about Bitcoin. That's why we have this high movement in value, because it is used as a speculation object, not as a normal day-to-day currency. So is a, in a certain way, Bitcoin as a currency was an experiment that failed, maybe, or it shifted to another focus. But I think it's okay still to accept it for what it is or what it was. And nowadays we have many, many cryptocurrencies every day. Tons of cryptocurrencies pop up. Most of them can be based on Ethereum. It's super easy. You can make your own cryptocurrency, like just with a little bit of code and launch it somewhere. And they are worth as much as the market gives it value. And here we have the top 10, but this is from like some months ago. It could be already different today. What is kind of stable is the fact that Bitcoin has by far the biggest overall value market cap, and Ethereum is on place 2. And in general, if you're touching this topic, this domain, it makes a lot of sense to focus on those two technologies as first and understand them and their dynamics and their history before you dive down into those very obscure and very different cryptocurrencies. So, yeah. And since Bitcoin is the biggest, we also will look a little bit in the technical background of Bitcoin, because it's one of the easiest way to understand blockchain as a concept. But Bitcoin is one example for a blockchain. There are many other blockchain technologies, and blockchain as a concept can be implemented in other ways. Still, Bitcoin is a good example because it is quite kind of well researched and very big community and kind of easy to understand also. So therefore, let's look into Bitcoin and what is Bitcoin itself. So Bitcoin is a decentralized peer-to-peer network. So it means we have all these different nodes, different servers running, and they connect to each other via peer-to-peer. And then together they spin up the Bitcoin network. After all those blockchain technologies came up, there is a new word that got kind of invented, constructed, and it's called distributed ledger technology. And basically all those blockchains, they can be defined as distributed ledger technology. Distributed ledger means you have kind of this public ledger. Ledger is like append only commit log, so to say. You have this public registry, this public commit log or append only log. And the fact is that it's distributed means you have it duplicated to all servers in the network. They all see the whole state of the ledger all the time, which is of course different from other decentralized systems where you have a small set of databases maybe that will keep the state. With those DLT technologies, you have everyone in the network has the same state, has the overview of all the state and all the historic state. Some might argue, but now I'm a bit careful in saying it, but maybe it's true. Maybe one can say Kafka is actually a DLT also. So something like Kafka or Apache Pulsar. And there are blockchain technologies that are built on top of Kafka. So maybe an argument for this as well. And then what Bitcoin is famous about is a proof of work concept. And we will look into a bit more detail on this topic in a bit. And the proof of work is also connected to another concept, and this is dynamic transaction fee. So when you do a transaction in Bitcoin, like I send you one Bitcoin, you have to pay a fraction of the transaction as transaction fees. And those fees go to the miners. The miners are the people operating the network, and that is their incentive. And when there is more load in the network, the transaction fees rise, and then more people are motivated to participate in the network. And yeah, it's kind of a clever economic way to solve this public resource usage dilemma, so to say. But yeah, this was Bitcoin 2009. Even when we go in the blockchain history, things start much earlier. And blockchain data structure, there's probably some discussion who invented it, but I think it's fair to say that dissertation paper from David Chaum from 82 is one of the first maybe defining works on this concept of a blockchain data structure. It was called Computer Systems Established, Maintained, and Trusted by Mutually Suspicious Groups. So there is a lot of activity on those topics in the cryptographic computer science industry or academia world, research world. And he is using the word chaining of blocks 2 times in his dissertation. And one time is chaining for encryption, like chaining blocks to have then one block that can be encrypted together. And then he's referencing an even older paper from 1970 from Horst Feistel, Cryptographic Coding for Data Bank Privacy. But the more interesting thing is probably this other quote. It is talking about chaining the checksums to secure the consensus state. So to secure those blocks that are chained together. And here we have a picture of David Chaum. And this is how Bitcoin does it. So let's have a look at the data structure. And in a nutshell, without the proof of work thing, we can look at the, can you see this? If I move, maybe not. So you can see at the top graphic how the blockchain data structure works. So you are hashing a block, the data contained in a block. Then you add the hash of the previous block and you calculate a new hash for this entry out of those two. And this is your hash. And this goes into the next hash again. So by every new block, you are securing the previous block one more step. And if you would want to manipulate one of the previous blocks, you have to recalculate all the hashes, basically. And that is the way it secures the integrity. So you can't change previous states or delete previous states without recalculating all following states. This is quite clever, I think, as a data structure. And it can be used for different use cases. And what Bitcoin adds is like a little bit another field, actually, the nonce. The nonce is used as part of the proof of work algorithm, which we will see in a bit. I will even have a live coding example of this, or not live coding, but we will see the Java code for proof of work. So let's dive into the proof of work stuff. And this is also cool. And this is also historic stuff. So the proof of work, and proof of work is this thing where Bitcoin has a lot of its bad reputation from. So people say Bitcoin uses so much energy, it's because of the proof of work. Proof of work is not good. We don't want to have proof of work. And that's the reason why Bitcoin is bad. But this is missing the point in some ways. Proof of work has been first mentioned or first conceptualized in a paper from 92 by Dvorak and Naur. And the paper was called Pricing via Processing on Combating Junk Mail. And this is a fantastic idea. So the idea was, if you have an unmetered resource, a resource that is free to use for everyone, and sending email in the internet is more or less free for everyone. As soon as you send out the email using your SMTP server, it gets delivered, kind of for free. And since this is for free, we have the problem with spam mail, with junk mail. And what they propose is, okay, we have to have transmission costs for sending emails. How can we do it? Okay, if we have an organization that controls the internet that just takes fees for transmissions, we can do it like this. But we want to have it in a more free way. We don't want to have a central entity controlling the things. So they proposed employing a pricing function, is some mathematical function that the sender of the email has to calculate. And then he can send the email and it gets only accepted if the pricing function was calculated correctly, else it gets rejected. So you're investing a little bit computing resources to be allowed to use the network. And in their paper, these computing costs are lost afterwards. You just invest them so you're allowed to send the email. And if you just send a couple of emails, it doesn't cost you anything, actually. It's basically for free because the pricing function is not so expensive. But if you are a spam mailer who sends out millions, it becomes too expensive for you, and then you can't use it anymore. Pretty good idea. But it wasn't implemented in practice. It's just a theoretical paper. And 99, we have another paper, and there it was the first time we used the word proof of work. They say proofs of work and bread potting protocols by Jacobson and Jules. And they have the same idea, but also propose reusing the invested computing resources. That's the idea of a bread pudding protocol. It comes from the food bread pudding, which you can make from old bread, I think is a British meal. And they say, okay, if we have to invest those computing resources, maybe we can use them for something useful. And they had the idea of calculating hash collisions, which is connected to another work from some cryptographers, Rivest and Shamir. And they had, back then in the 90s, they had already this context of coins and minting coins and cryptographic coins. And they were minted by finding hash collisions. They said, okay, let's calculate those hash collisions. Thereby you generate coins that they can then be used for as coins for something. Yeah, they can be used at least to pay this transmission of email. So what I love about this stuff is that this is from the 90s. And back then already, we have the theoretical and sometimes even practical concepts behind this blockchain Bitcoin stuff. I think very important to understand the history. Now, the proof of work that became super famous is the one used by Bitcoin, and it was called Hashcash, and it's also from 1997. It was invented by Adam Back. And actually, he was not really aware of the other academic papers on this topic, so he kind of came up with the idea by himself. So he wasn't aware of the work by Dvorak and Naur, as far as I know, as far as he says. He learned about them later. Still fundamentally the same idea. We want to combat junk mail, exactly the same. And it also works by finding a hash collision. And we are calculating a hash of this kind of different fields. And most of them are implicitly part of the email. So like you have the address, you have the hash of the content, you have a date and so on. And then you have a counter at the end. And this counter you can control. The rest is fixed. And by controlling this counter, you now have to find a hash collision with a SHA-1. And the hash collision is with a SHA with 5 leading zeros, for example, or N leading zeros. There's a proof of work as defined by Hashcash. And then the email servers would reject emails if they would not provide such a Hashcash header. It was also practically implemented back then, but not widely adopted by the internet. And Bitcoin uses exactly this algorithm for its proof of work. Incrementing a nonce, this was called counter in the other example. Bitcoin calls it nonce. And then a SHA-256 of a block header is calculated. And then you have to find this hash collision. And now I will show some Java code that shows how to do this. All right. So this is like now the super simple blockchain that is just running locally in my Java virtual machine, but it's not the blockchain as a network. It's just a local single blockchain data structure, so to say. And we have a class block, and the block contains some data, arbitrary data, and it contains the previous hash, and it contains a nonce. That's basically it as a data structure. Now, if we want to interact with it, we can create a new block. We have to use a mining function. Mining is called mining, finding this hash collision. The mining function is finding a collision with this many leading zeros. And if we look at the mining function, that's fundamentally what Bitcoin is doing internally. We calculate our hash, the hash of our block. It is just calculated as a SHA-256 of the previous hash together with our data, all strings, by the way, previous hash with the data and a nonce. So, and now my mining algorithm, my proof of work mining algorithm, just basically the same as Bitcoin implements it, is calculating the hash as long until it finds a hash that starts with as many zeros as the difficulty. So difficulty here is 4. Hash collision with 4 leading zeros. That's it. Then we can use it like here, and I just run it, and then we see it takes a couple of seconds. Okay, so mining the first block takes a couple of milliseconds, 600. And here we see, since I just sequentially increment the nonce, we had to try basically 200,000 values until we find a nonce that provides us with this hash collision. And obviously trying out 200,000 values in this case takes around 600 milliseconds. So not too expensive, but kind of expensive. If I do this for millions of data points, for millions of blocks, it becomes quite expensive. And then me as a malicious user wanting to exploit a common resource, I can't do it anymore. But as a normal user, it's fine. Now the next block I add, so we have the block here. Then I can add a new block that is connected with the hash of the previous block. So I just do it here by hand. I can have a different data structure, more connected already. I just do it here by hand, connecting blocks with each other, and then mine them, find out the nonce. And here I just had to try out 90,000 different values, so much faster. And we can see that this difficulty of finding the hash collision increases dramatically by the amount of collision I want to have. So just adding one more difficulty, basically. And already takes over 1 second. And now I had to find 600,000. I had to try out 600,000 values to find them. And if I add even more, it takes even longer, and so on and so on. I think you get the idea. And that's what Bitcoin does. This is a proof of work of Bitcoin. So people always say like, oh, you have to solve a cryptographic puzzle, whatever. Yeah, you just increment a counter by one until you find this hash collision. That's all what they do, basically. And this, of course, burns some energy. And especially in the case of Bitcoin, since people get this transaction fee for solving this, for finding this nonce, for then mining a block. And we have Bitcoin as a speculating value. So people are speculating on Bitcoin, therefore they can invest a lot of, or want to invest a lot of energy. Like you have those big mining pools in China and so on, where the energy is maybe cheaper than the Bitcoin you can get out of it. And yeah, that's of course not so cool, but okay. So we saw here, now I had to try out many, many things. So that's how proof of work works in Bitcoin, basically in a nutshell. So I will switch again to the, yeah, and I have to be a little bit fast. I see I try to be quick because I want to touch on so many more topics. So blockchain is a big topic. I could talk about it long, long time. Someone says hash collision. So why are we trying to find the hash collision? It's a partial collision. We want to find a partial collision, and we don't want to find this collision because it's useful or used for anything else. It's just because we know it takes quite some time to find this collision, and thereby we can prove, this is about proving that computing resources were invested. That's all. Okay, and then encryption stuff. So encryption has nothing to do with this at this point. So this is not about encrypting anything. It's just about proving that you invested computing resources, CPU cycles, basically, because each increment is one CPU cycle, plus calculating the SHA is even more. Yeah, I hope this helps a little bit. Of course, after the talk, you can ask me many more questions. I try to answer them as best as possible. But it's also a good point. So these proof of works reverse many cryptographic concepts, because instead of proving that we possess a secret, we are now proving that we invested computing resources. It is really a bit strange from a classical cryptographic point of view, but that's how they work. So what I want to touch on is that there can be now in reality many different forms of blockchains. So there are these open blockchain networks, and Bitcoin and the public Ethereum are examples for open blockchain networks, and they are as open as the internet is open, and they have properties. They are called five pillars of open blockchains, and blockchain hardcore people say a real blockchain has to comply to those pillars. And they contain things like they have to be open so everyone can participate. Everyone needs to be able to read the blockchain network. They have to work over any boundaries of nation states. They have to be neutral, not controlled by central parties, and be censorship resistant. So not a central party can say, okay, you're not allowed to perform the transactions on this one. Yes, have to be public, readable for everyone. So this is what the hardliner, the community hardliners say, what a blockchain has to be a blockchain. But in reality, we see we have a more or less a spectrum of different blockchains. that can be used for different use cases. And that can be also used in companies maybe or in enterprises. So Ethereum, Bitcoin are public and open, but another kind of blockchain that is very famous and especially in Europe is getting established now a lot are public closed blockchains, or sometimes called public permissioned. In those, all the data is still readable, but the people operating or the nodes operating the network have to be authorized to operate them. And then you, instead of using a proof of work, you can use something called proof of authority. Proof of authority is just showing a certificate and say, okay, yes, I'm the university XYZ, I'm allowed to operate a network here. By the way, so we are part of a blockchain network for academic use cases. It's called Bloxburg, and we have we run over a proof of authority. So you just have to enroll in this network, then you have to prove that you're in university, and then you can control a node, and these nodes then mine blocks just by proving their authority. And Boğaziçi University in Istanbul is also one of the nodes. Yes, I just remembered this. So these are called proof of authority networks, and they are very useful for a lot of applications, use cases, which I'm not diving into it here now in detail, but here we have examples for voting, whistleblowing, like maybe disclosing data, and like not for financial transactions, but for using something where you can, where you want to have a public registry for something. Yes, so what Fatih explains is correct. Yeah, exactly. By having this nonce, you proved that you found the nonce, and everyone can see you took the time to find this nonce. So sadly, I'm running out of time, and there are so many more topics to talk about. Like the other one, super important, is smart contracts. Smart contracts are very much related to the whole blockchain topic. And what are smart contracts? So people often mix up what are smart contracts really. And I'm jumping over some slides. So the core idea of smart contracts is to have code in the blockchain that gets also executed in the blockchain based on events that happen in the blockchain. And the code is public and visible for everyone. And the execution of this code is also distributed. And this is, I think, kind of the one of the game changers in blockchain technology and blockchain networks, having this distributed computer. And this is what Ethereum brings us. Now, what for me is important to tell you is that those smart contracts, they are called contracts, but they are not really a substitute for contracts as defined by human society. I think you can think of a smart contract really like something like a serverless function. And we will see an example for smart contract code. So the technology that made smart contracts famous is Ethereum. And Ethereum was first described in 2013 by Vitalik Buterin, who was a bit unhappy with Bitcoin's limitations. So Bitcoin has a scripting language built in, Bitcoin script, that can trigger transactions based on other transactions to a certain degree, but it is very limited. And he envisioned having code in the blockchain that can execute based on blockchain events, blockchain transactions, that is Turing complete. And so they came up with this Ethereum virtual machine, a little bit similar in certain ways to Java virtual machine, that can execute Ethereum bytecode and is quasi Turing complete. It's not really Turing complete because it uses something called gas to not run into infinite loops, but basically Turing complete. And it has rich statefulness in the sense that all the historic states a contract ever had can be seen from the history of the blockchain. And you can use this technology to develop something called DApps, decentralized applications. And they are super cool because the idea of decentralized application is that you have certain business logic not running in the client, not running on the server, but instead have business logic running in the network as part of the smart contract. And the Bloxburg I mentioned is a proof of authority network based on Ethereum. Yeah, and there are many other examples. And the famous Ethereum network is called Ethereum. So Ethereum mainnet is an Ethereum network, but you can have other Ethereum networks that can have different names, but that use the Ethereum technology. So this is a little bit confusing if you first go into this topic. And it's also like you can run your own private Ethereum network. So Oracle Cloud, Azure have certain applications there for. Yes, I will, Oracle, I will share my slides after the talk. And here we see how a smart contract looks. And yeah, smart contracts, this is in Solidity, is a programming language for writing smart contracts. They then get down compiled into Ethereum bytecode. And basically, an Ethereum smart contract is very similar to something like a Java class. So you see already the shape is a bit similar than a class. So you have the contract name is like a class name. You have fields in the contract, and then you have functions or methods in the contract. Very similar than a Java class. And now what you can do, you can instantiate this contract by deploying it into a blockchain, into a Ethereum blockchain. That is like creating an object, and then you can interact with it. And I will just use the remaining time I have to quickly show you how to do it, because there is a technology called Web3J, then you can interact with Ethereum in Java. So let me quickly show you some more code, because I want you to see how easy this whole smart contract stuff really is. All right, so I'm back here. So I'm having here a smart contract now that just can store a number. So you can just store a number in the blockchain using the smart contract, but it also will give you the history of all numbers that ever have been stored in the smart contract implicitly, because that's how Ethereum blockchain works. This is Solidity code. And by using, using a Maven plugin called Web3J Maven plugin, which I configured here in my Maven, Web3J Maven plugin, I can automatically compile this into a Java proxy class, which is super cool. It looks like this. So this is a Java class that got now compiled or transpiled from the Solidity code. It contains the Ethereum bytecode as a binary here in the string field, and it contains constructors and all the methods this smart contract has as Java methods. And then I can interact with this contract just as I would interact with an object, and calling all the functions is then like calling functions from a web API, kind of, but it looks like kind of native. So if we look at this example, sorry, where I have it. Ah, you have to live with a Groovy example, sorry. Or maybe not sorry, it's cool. So I'm now connecting, I'm creating a Web3J client. And now I have to, so it's a topic we never talked about yet. So here I have to specify a private key. So in these Ethereum applications, you don't have, or blockchain applications, you don't have username password. You always have public private key pairs, like with SSH. So, and in this case, I have to load my credentials, which are called a wallet, and I have to specify a private key. So now you see my private key here, it's leaked, it's lost forever, but it's a demo key. And I have a local blockchain running. You don't see because the screen is not shared. It's called Ganache. And there it provides me with these accounts. But let me just use another key here. So hereby, I now have an account basically that I can use to interact with Ethereum. Here, I'm having this storage Java proxy class. I'm deploying it on this network I specified here. Okay, it's running locally. The node is running locally, but it could be connected to other nodes in the internet. And then I have different kind of APIs, synchronous, asynchronous, reactive, but here I'm calling the synchronous, I just send it. And yeah, let's just run it and see what happens. And then the time runs out. All right, so yeah, then I can interact with it, like retrieve for retrieving the value, store for storing the value, storing another value, retrieving another value. And we see kind of those things happening. And now I could have more business logic in the smart contract, and it's more interesting, but still you can see, okay, a smart contract is like an object you can interact with. It's an object that is living in an Ethereum network, in an Ethereum blockchain. Yes, so let me then, I don't know, jump to the end of my slides. Thank you very much. I will share my slides. I will stay in here for Yes, that was the code. There's also cool extension with test containers. Blah, blah. Yes, you can also use Oracle for blockchain. All right. Thank you very much. Very happy that I could share this topic with you. I will share the slides. I will just tweet them, or maybe I can just post them in the chat here in Hopin. It's maybe better. And I will stay in the channel here for further questions as long as I can, or as long as I want. And yes, I would also be happy to see you in the future again in Istanbul. Thank you very much. So my area of research, so when you start the PhD, you have a rough idea what you're going to, and then it like moves into other directions. So I originally wanted to work on the field of smart contract verification. So basically like testing, like normal software testing, you also need to test the smart contract code. And there is not too much work actually involved in this yet. So there is some stuff in this verification, formal verification. Also, there are testing frameworks, but they are not super advanced as compared to classical software engineering. So that was one area I was originally interested in, but I more or less pivoted more into the direction of applying blockchain for securing the integrity of scientific research processes. So what we are working on also in the context of Bloxburg is basically different integrations of your research workflow, like your normal research, like when you're a chemist or something, like doing experiments, to constantly update and timestamp the research data you're gathering in the blockchain, the hashes of it, and the raw data, and then you connect it with analyzed data, then you see, this analyzed data came out of this raw data, it was created by this source code that run the analysis, and so on, and that you in the end have a whole research process that is secured by the blockchain transactions so that it can't be manipulated when you publish your paper, or when you publish the paper, people can at least see, these results, they don't really end up because the raw data here had many more subjects, and for some reason they just run the analysis with half of the subjects. Is a pretty interesting research field, and I think there can be very useful applications coming out of this from blockchain. So what is a lot? What is if you have to update contracts? This is a good question. So there are patterns for this. The problem is, so if you deploy a contract, you can never update the contract itself, and the contract is stored at a specific address in the network, like a public key. So this is called the address. Now what you have to do, if you wanna update it, you actually have to use something is called a proxy pattern, proxy delegate pattern. So you have a smart contract that has as a data field, the location of the smart contract to use. Then your application asks this proxy, okay, what is the address of the smart contract I should use? It answers, then it goes there, and then you can update the address of a new smart contract there. That's a pattern you can use. If you have students, bachelor students, master students, PhD students that are interested in research topics, they can get in touch with me on Twitter, for example. Twitter is the best way to get in touch with me, and we can discuss collaborations and research topics. And especially for bachelor and master students, I can also advise CSIS work or other student projects that are open. Yes, and our institute is collaborating with other people. And we can also talk with the people from Bogazici University, the computer science department that is involved in Bloxburg. Definitely a possibility. Where can we use blockchain? What industries? How do we foresee its future? So there are different fields that are pushing into blockchain. One that is very blockchain interested is supply chain management, and there you basically use it to track your supply chain and the processes or steps of your supply chain. So it becomes very interesting in these points where you have different parties that need to interact with each other, and the parties maybe not mutually trust each other to 100%. And if you have 20 companies that are involved in a supply chain, like, for example, bringing parts for a car, producing and delivering and supplying parts to a car. You can probably onboard them, or you have a higher chance of onboarding them, of using this blockchain-based system together, because everyone can operate a node instead of saying, okay, just, I don't know, BMW is controlling this one server and you all have to use this server, but they could in theory then override the data there. So it is then interesting if you have different parties collaborating to with each other that don't trust each other 100%. And it is also very interesting for use cases in with regards to government use cases, where you want to provide complete transparency to the citizens. And this is also an area where we are quite active in. And it is connected with another kind of application or concept, which is called SSI, Self-Sovereign Identity. And this is has one blockchain component, but many other blockchain components, web components from the W3C, like verifiable credentials, decentralized identifiers, and so on. And in this SSI concept, you have a model where you get credentials from an issuer, for example, the government, like your driving license and so on, and they are not stored on central servers. They are stored on your personal devices. They are called wallets. It can be your phone. And the correctness of those credentials are stored via some cryptographic registers that are stored in the blockchain. It's quite a very complex system, but there's a lot of activity in this area. And there is an activity now, it's called Trust over IP. And it's from the Linux Foundation. And we have a lot of big players in there, like IBM and so on. And they try to push this this topic to bringing decentralized identification and certification into the internet, basically. Yeah. So I like this idea very much because it goes towards decentralization and which tries to go away from centralizing everything on those some core internet providers we have right now, service providers like Google, Microsoft, Oracle. I'm not saying anything against them, but we should think if that we might be able to develop technology that is more decentralized. I think this is a good idea. Okay, what Fatih asked, do Mars heavily involved in formal verification of smart contracts? So it is very similar to formal verification of other computing languages, of other programming languages, and you are doing kind of formal verification on the assembly part of the things, and then you have to have some formal verification of the underlying machine that runs it, which for Ethereum is the Ethereum virtual machine. But to be honest, I didn't dive too deep in this topic, especially not the formal verification part. So it's probably a part of a kind of an applied mathematics thingy, but very computer sciencey also. Yes. So Bitcoin scalability, yes. Scalability is a problem in those networks because they increase, they just become bigger and bigger, and they never clean themselves up. There are different approaches to those scalability stuff, and they are always trade-off. So the scalability is a problem. So if you have to wait a long time for the network to confirm a transaction, this is one problem, of course. Like, yeah. And how is this solved? It can be solved by partitioning the network. And maybe this is the only way to solve it. So saying, okay, if we have this partition of the network that confirms the transaction, I trust that the transaction will be valid. And this is one of the scaling approaches that also Ethereum takes in certain parts. Sometimes it's called sharding or this plasma concept. But of course, this can decrease the trust a little bit, because then also attacking this partition might allow to attack part of the network then and so on. So it is a trade-off. But you can't scale a completely peer-to-peer connected network where every participant is connected with everyone with all algorithms we know. So that's not possible. But also Bitcoin is not solving the synchronization using classical distributed systems algorithms for synchronization, which would be called Byzantine fault tolerant algorithms. Bitcoin uses this mining thing, and this just ran a bit out of proportion. So the difficulty now is very high. Therefore, it takes long to also find these hash collisions. And therefore, you need a lot of mining power to participate. And this is also a problem because of using this speculative aspect of Bitcoin. So yes, very complex topic. We have a lot of different research proposals working on it. But with regards to Bitcoin, what it could mean is that Bitcoin will never be able to be a system for small transactions. So you have to add layers on it. This is another approach, adding a different layer. And then you can do many small transactions that are maybe confirmed faster, which is what the Bitcoin Lightning Network is doing as far as I know, but I'm not a Bitcoin expert. And then they get put into one block that is then very big, and it can take 10 minutes, 20 minutes to confirm it's okay. Yeah, interesting topic. But another way to solve it is have more networks. So with these consortium-run proof of authority networks, that's what we're doing in Europe to a certain degree, maybe. Ismail, good question. Yes, I will share a link with you. So this is how you can start with developing a DApp, I think. It's a very good tooling. It's called Truffle. It's connected, so it's for Ethereum. And you can use Truffle, like you have all the parts you need in there. So you have Truffle as a build system for Solidity contracts. You have Ganache, which you can use to run a local test Ethereum network. And you have Drizzle, which is connecting the smart contract with your web front end. And they integrate with React, as far as I know. Yeah, so this is a good starting point if you want to use a framework, but you can also do stuff by hand. What you would use then is Web3. Web3, I also sent the link here. This is the standard way to integrate JavaScript with Ethereum blockchain. And then you have a Web3 variant for every language, basically. For Java, you have Web3J, you have Web3 Python, and so on. This is how you can connect the things. Yeah, there are also a lot of good resources on Ethereum, official of Ethereum website. Cool. Yeah, and else, just ping me on Twitter. I would like to help you if you have any questions, explain more stuff. And if you have students that want to do research in this area, also ping me, and I'm sure we can find really cool collaborations. And also, I'm always interested in writing cool papers, academic papers. Yes. Thank you very much. It was a joy. And see you all in the future, I hope, in Istanbul. And then we can all have some nice cockroach. Goodbye. Inshallah. Yes. Inshallah. Güle güle. Leave button. I leave now. Güle güle. Teşekkürler.